It's my pleasure to welcome you all to this webinar by Evora IT Solutions and SAP India, which is supported by Manufacturing Today. Today's webinar is on how to bring your maintenance to a new level by using mobile, connected, sensor board and smart technology. We are humbled to see the fabulous response we have received so far for this webinar. Let me start with a brief introduction about ITP. ITP Media is one of the largest foreign media company in India. The group is headquartered out of Dubai and now publishes more than 100 weekly and monthly magazines and has a wide portfolio of market-leading digital and event properties. Coming to this webinar, plant heads are in a constant endeavor to effect improvement in return on assets, improvement in first-time fix rate, and reduction in unplanned asset downtime. So with a multitude of solutions now available to address these goals, the need is for an integrated and synchronized platform. For this, we have our experts. Let me quickly introduce you to them. We have Mr. John Wilson. He heads the Global Center of Excellence, SAP Digital Supply Chain. Hi, John.
Good morning.
Good morning. We have Namita Kustagi, Director of Evora IT Solutions. Hi, Namita.
Hi, Sujit. Hi, everybody. Welcome.
And we have Disha Pala, Senior Consultant with Evora IT Solutions. So without further ado, Namita, I request you to take this.
Hello, everybody. Welcome to the session. And nice having you here. I hope all of you are keeping safe and not really affected majorly by this pandemic that is going on. But nevertheless, life has to go on, and that's why we are here. So a quick introduction. I'm Namita. I'm the director of Evora IT Solutions. So today we will be talking about the SAP Intelligent Asset Management session that we have planned here. This is the agenda that we are having. We will be talking briefly about an overview of the SAP IAM topic itself, where John will be running us through some content. And next, I will just introduce briefly about ourselves more in detail about what Evora IT is all about. Then we'll delve a little deeper into the equipment and its ecosystems and how things are in the current scenario without using the IAM, and then go into a little bit introduction into the components, what is there into IAM. And then also we will show you a demo. We'll get you into the system to show you what are all the different ways you can manage the IAM, what are all the facilities that are available, what are all the features. We will go spend a little bit more time during the demo itself. And coming to the Amplify package, we will also from Evora IT tell you what Amplify packages are all about, what are we doing, how we can work together with SAP, Evora and you. So that will be the Amplify package topic. And then moving on, we will have the Q&A, which is like we will reserve some time for questions and answers, wherein we will take up the answers. So I would like, before we move on, I would like to just maybe ask a quick question about, we'll run a small poll here, and we would want to know how many of you are already aware of the intelligent asset management itself, which SAP has introduced. Sorry for that. Yeah. So the question is already in front of you. So please click on yes or no. This will give us kind of an idea as to where we are and just an understanding of how the audience is.
Delegates, the poll is flashing in front of the screen. Please select your appropriate option.
So we have a yes of 22% and no of 78%. This is really great for us to have this information. So moving on to the next content, I will call in John. John, you want to take over? I'll move on to the next slide.
Fantastic. Thank you, Namita. And thank you, Evora, for inviting me to join this session. We clearly have a number of people who are not that familiar with SAP's Intelligent Asset Management portfolio. So it's great for me to maybe introduce this topic and really what are some of the challenges that we're trying to address. And in my role, you know, as part of the Global Center of Excellence, I speak to people who work in a whole range of different industries, whether it's energy, natural resources, travel and transportation, public sector and critical infrastructure. And I mean, a lot of the feedback that we get around the challenges is very similar, even across all of those different industries. And a lot of that relates to disconnection and siloing of information, of the people and of the process across the end-to-end asset management operation. And really, this is making it very difficult for people who are responsible for managing assets to, you know, to execute their work and execute their operations effectively. There are some other trends that we're seeing changing across the industries as well, right? We're seeing a shift in the roles between the different parties that are responsible for asset management. And a lot of this is related to the complexity of the assets that are being managed. And so operators of those assets now are increasingly looking to the manufacturers and looking to service providers to assist them with, you know, understanding those assets and operating those assets. So we're seeing an increased role from manufacturers and from service providers in supporting ongoing operations. We're also seeing a shift away from quite static and reactive maintenance policies that, you know, that kind of maybe are planned as part of the initial installation, to much more dynamic approach. So actually using the information about the operation of the asset, the data that's coming from that asset, and fitting the, you know, the maintenance approach, the maintenance policies that are being put in place to fit those operating conditions and the actual results that we're seeing. One of the challenges in trying to do that, in trying to introduce that dynamic approach, is the need to connect and access the data that you have. So we see a lot of our customers have access to much more data than they had in the past. But of course, having access to the data is not enough. I need to be able to understand that data in context, and I need to be able to use that data to drive my maintenance policies and my maintenance processes. And so we have to be able to break down, you know, some of those silos, particularly between sort of maybe the operational teams and the enterprise teams. We need to be able to link not just our asset management processes, but our logistics processes, our human capital processes, our financial processes, and bring all of these things together. And of course, you know, we're doing this in a world where we are constrained. You know, there are a number of constraints, whether it's access to resources, whether it's our ability to move, whether it's the availability of spare parts, whether it's the cost budgets that we're working to. There are a number of constraints, and those constraints are getting tighter and tighter, and yet we are expected to deliver more and more operational performance and higher levels of safety. So getting that balance right, getting that integration, getting that visibility is really quite key to being able to manage those constraints. And lastly, you know, around the whole dynamics of the people who are working in asset intensive operations, you know, we're seeing a lot of new people coming into the industries that, you know, being trained up. And it's really important that we work in a safe and a sustainable way. So we protect our people, we protect the planet. So we're seeing, you know, those dynamics changing as well. A couple of the areas that SAP is looking at, you know, before we get into, I guess, the asset management portfolio, a couple of overarching themes. One of these is the concept of a digital thread. And, you know, you may be familiar with the term digital twin, you know, that kind of that mirror of a physical object with a digital object. At SAP, we often talk about the digital thread because really this is going beyond just a point in time representation, but actually trying to bring information from throughout the life cycle. So right from when an asset is first envisaged, maybe from when it's first designed, when it's constructed or manufactured, all the way through into its handover into operations, obviously that ongoing operations and maintenance, any refurbishment, and then eventually through into decommissioning. And so that whole asset life cycle generates data, and that data can be used and flow throughout that life cycle. And so when at SAP, when we think about the digital thread, it's about gathering all of that data that is generated through that life cycle and making it available to support the ongoing processes and also to feedback. So, you know, if I'm designing a new asset, I want to be able to take feedback from that design once it's in operation, so that the next time I come to do a similar design, I can maybe improve on it. So it's about flowing information, you know, through the life cycle, but also creating those feedback loops so that we can actually, you know, improve our business processes over time. The next major, you know, strategy that SAP is working on, and Namita, if you can just move to the next slide, is all around, you know, what we call the business network, the unified business network. So actually, you know, and I mentioned this, you know, earlier, you know, operators now are not working in isolation. They're collaborating with the manufacturers and the constructors of their assets. They're collaborating with the service providers. And they're doing that across a range of different dimensions, whether it's around procurement or whether it's around logistics or whether it's around the assets themselves. And so we're seeing increasingly this need to shift from maybe business processes that are focused on a single organization to a much more collaborative business process that actually brings together multiple parties, that allows information to be shared across organizational boundaries to create this business community, this network of people who have a common interest and a common shared understanding of the assets and the processes that we're working on. So these, you know, in the past, SAP has had multiple business networks. So we had the Ariba business network that supported our procurement activities. We had the logistics business network that supported track and trace and freight collaboration. We had the asset intelligence network that supported collaboration around assets and work. And one of the strategies we have now is to unify those networks together. So actually there is a single business network that provides access to all of that information and connect that through into the broader business community. So just looking at the SAP Intelligent Asset Management portfolio, it has a number of different parts to it. We were just talking about, you know, networks and collaboration. So you can see this is the sort of the outer circle here that that really goes through all of the different business processes that we are adopting in the asset management space. So networks and collaboration are key, as is mobility. We want to unchain everyone who's involved in the asset management process away from the desk. You know, we want them to be able to work wherever they need to. So whether it's in the field, whether it's in front of the customer, you know, we want them to be able to, sorry, Namita, if you just go back to, we want them to be able to work wherever they need to and to have access to all of the information that they need to and all of those business processes. One of the big areas that SAP is focused on, it's at the top of this circle, is around the area of asset performance management. And so this is a relatively new space for SAP. In the past, we've partnered, and now SAP is really looking to develop our solutions in this space because we have seen the challenges that we've had in the past, and we see the challenges that even partners have had in trying to integrate in with our core maintenance and service operations. And so actually, SAP has now developed tools that support risk and criticality assessment, that supports reliability-centered maintenance. Sorry, Namita, we keep moving forward. So maybe
I think there's a hint on that.
Maybe it's a hint that I need to talk faster. So doing failure modes and effects analysis or reliability-centered maintenance. So a number of different methodologies there that we can use then to make recommendations about which maintenance strategies we put in place. And then, of course, we enact those in our maintenance and service operations inside our ERP. And then we monitor that through asset health prediction and optimization. So that monitoring, you know, we use Industry 4.0 or IoT technologies to be able to collect information from our assets and use that as part of our ongoing monitoring diagnostic processes. And of course, then when we get into the core elements of identifying work, planning and scheduling work, dispatching work and executing work, these are core elements of SAP's portfolio and have been for many years. And we continue to enhance those as part of our new releases of our ERP solutions. And of course, we shouldn't forget the area on the right here around environmental health and safety. So as I mentioned before, this is about, you know, protecting the safety of our workers in the field. So ensuring that they have the appropriate permits in place, the appropriate protections in place, and also protecting the safety of our planet, so environmental controls as well. So an end-to-end integrated suite for asset management that goes from the very start of an asset's life cycle all the way through to decommissioning, and connects that through into the operational data and networks as well. And so really this is what SAP refers to as SAP's intelligent asset management portfolio. The presentation wants to get to this next slide. So my last one, just talking a little bit about the process to get there. So where do you start and what do we see? And so many of our customers, and you know, we have thousands of customers worldwide who are using SAP's asset management solution for core work order management. And this is often the place where they will start. So this is all around, you know, planning my work, scheduling my work, and executing my work. And, you know, being able to, you know, to do that for, you know, reactive work, you know, emergency work, but also planned inspections, preventative work as well. So having a work order management solution in place is typically a foundational element for transforming asset management. So I understand my assets, I understand the work that's being done. The next stage is then to look at, and Namita, if you just advance the build. Yeah, the next stage then is to look at risk and reliability planning. So moving away from that static, you know, sort of maintenance plan where I set and then just execute, but actually creating a regular risk and reliability planning process where I review the risk and criticality of my assets, I put in place the appropriate methodology, and I conduct regular assessments to ensure that the maintenance strategies that I'm putting in place are indeed the right ones. The next step in this is then to start to bring some of that data, some of that operational data that I have from my assets, so I can do first maybe understand the current condition and look at condition-based maintenance, and then move on to more predictive type approaches where I'm not just looking at what's happening right now, but actually starting to think about where might I be in the future, so I can actually start to predict and start to plan, start to order ahead, start to organize my resources so that actually I can intervene if I need to and I can be much more responsive. And the final stage in this maturity is really to start to take advantage of some of the, you know, the more sophisticated technologies out there, like artificial intelligence or like engineering simulation, to be able to go beyond just a simple digital representation of an asset, but actually to get to much more advanced models. So to be able to understand things like remaining useful life, being able to plan for replacements of assets, and do some of that, you know, that more long-term planning, and also move from a, you know, a predictive approach to a more prescriptive approach, where not only am I understanding what might go wrong, but I'm also being informed as to what my options might be and what the best option in terms of my response might be. And so we're seeing an evolution of asset management systems, you know, in this way. So with that, I might hand back to you, Namita, to talk a little bit more about how SAP and Evora are working together, and I look forward to seeing the demonstration a little bit later on as well.
Yes, sure, John, thank you so much. So moving on, I'll just introduce a little bit from Evora IT perspective. So we are Evora, and we have been working along with SAP since quite some time now in the areas of mobility and scheduling predominantly. And we have pretty good experience, I would say, in terms of handling mobile asset management and workforce management. And we are a consulting and software provider company, also located in around 5 locations as of now. We are located in US, Germany, Austria, Brazil, and India. And we also are having our a gold partner with SAP. We are based out in Bangalore, India, as of now in India at least, but we are also in the plans of expanding to Noida in the future. So we are around 100 plus employees in India and 150 plus globally. We were established in 2011. It's been quite a long journey. And So if you look at our portfolio, we have been working with SAP predominantly in the mobility and scheduling areas. Mainly, we believe that with mobility, the scheduling is also very important. With just being on the job, on the field technician also needs scheduling to be taken care of. So this is where our expertise comes in. So we bring in expertise in the areas of mobility, scheduling, and custom applications as well, wherein we even have our own products within Evora, which are also on the SAP store. So then going on with intelligent asset management as well, we have, ever since SAP introduced this, we have been working in predominantly all the areas of intelligent asset management with all the areas that John just covered. We have expertise in that itself. So this is, again, talking about the technologies and platforms that we currently work on, but I wouldn't want to really get into too much details and spoil the flow of the content that is going on. So I would like directly jump into the next topic. Yeah, so I would want to introduce what equipment and its ecosystem is all about. John made a pretty good explanation about how it is with the intelligent asset management and things like that. But maybe we can also go a little step back and see what it is in the current scenario, you know, without using an intelligent asset management solution provided by SAP. So now, nowadays, if you can relate to your, I know you all come from an industry background and you are pretty much familiar with all the equipment and assets that you have within your organization. So when you look at this equipment or an asset, the life cycle of this equipment is like pretty complex nowadays, right? Now you have, there are many people who are making an equipment, there are manufacturers, right? Then there are people who own it and who operate it, right? Then there are also other people who service it, who service the item or the asset, which whenever it needs servicing. So the big picture of the equipment is kind of really big. And now it's a really a complex thing, wherein the trouble is that when you have to see where all the pieces fit in, how all the manufacturers, the owners, and the service technicians all together, how do they come together and form their own ecosystem? The current, so I would like to do this with the help of an example, right? With introducing a little roles with who is a designer or a manufacturer, and then who's an operator, and then you also have a service. So I have Priya here, who's an equipment manufacturer. So she's a design engineer. She's responsible for the product development and improvement of this particular product. Okay. Now her job is not really easy because there are multiple incompatible system interfaces here. There's no data there is data inconsistency, and there is a different search criteria in different systems. So then for her, it is quite challenging for her to know how her asset is currently being used, okay, across different industries, across different owners who have owned it. So she just doesn't get a real-time data of how her product is being used for her to even evolve that particular product, right? Going on with Anuj, who's an operator, he's a reliability engineer. Basically, he's responsible for, you know, planning, then creating, and even managing the maintenance strategies. I'm sure that you can relate to when I say maintenance strategies, what they are and what kind of strategies can be had. So this person is responsible for the maintenance strategies and, you know, introducing even the corrective maintenance strategies as well. And his goal is basically to maximize this maintenance cycle and reduce the downtime of this asset, right? So he is focused mainly on keeping everything running. His goal is, you know, to continually improve and then you maximize the maintenance cycles itself. But then the problem that he has is he has, everyone is also using that particular equipment. So he's usually working with outdated and inconsistent equipment data. So for him, this does not give him a full view of how he needs to change the strategies or how he needs to change what the maintenance cycles are. So he's usually working with old data and this is not really helping him out. Then we also have Pankaj, who's the servicer. He's basically responsible for maintaining the equipment itself. So he's the person who, you know, he inspects, he repairs, he tests, installs, and, you know, he maintains the equipment. But then that also includes, you know, the safety checks that needs to be carried out, the maintenance jobs that needs to be done, and even recording and reporting the work that needs to be done. Time spent, how much of time he has spent on each thing. So now he needs to he needs access to the maintenance instructions of this particular asset, which will tell him how to perform his job, then what the safety considerations are, how he needs to take care of certain things and things like this, and even maybe information about spare parts, right? Now he wants an easy way to do all this reporting. So, but then it's not really currently possible to have a unified approach among all these three roles. And that is where we see quite a few challenges, which I just briefly mentioned. Now, if you see Priya, she does not get a full view of the equipment usage. The service technician, the reliability engineer, he works with outdated, inconsistent data. The operator itself, he lacks the maintenance instructions, safety considerations, and things like this. So this is where the IAM comes into picture in gathering all this into a single cloud-based solution. Yeah, it is a cloud-based Internet of Things, which, you know, kind of unifies all these kind of operators, all these OEMs that are there. It brings them all together. Now, if you see in this particular slide, we have the traditional scenario wherein you have time-based inspection planning, wherein you need to carry out your inspection planning at a certain time, right? It is scheduled via your maintenance plans. And this is what we saw with the previous example as well. Then a service technician, he goes on, the inspection is conducted, he triggers the maintenance work, and then he also updates into his work orders or notifications, or, you know, with having an SAP background. So, but then with the new world with SAP, what we are planning or what we are trying to speak here is about introducing sensors here, which will kind of monitor the equipment performance itself, which will tell, okay, this equipment is going wrong. So these sensors could be of different various types. It could be of which is monitoring the temperature around the equipment. Okay, it reaches a particular temperature, and then it sends a notification to the control center, which is sent to the supervisor. Then it is also, the supervisor is also aware that, okay, this there is some concern with this equipment, and he can take necessary actions. Or you can also have it in the system itself, where you can create your own notifications based on certain alerts that are going to come in the system. We will see this in more detail when we perform the demo, when we show you the demo as to how you can configure certain rules and certain alerts via which notifications in the ERP system can be taken care and created. So in this approach, if you see, it's moving, as John mentioned, it is moving from a preventive maintenance to a predictive style here. And that is where the whole of IAM comes into picture. This is kind of similar to whatever John already discussed about. I brought in this slide mainly to focus on a little bit about the Asset Central Foundation that you see here. This is in the middle of the circle that you see the yellow part, right? So that itself is where the Asset Central Foundation is nothing but the digital twin that we referred to some time ago. And this is where the whole database of the ERP backend system is residing now on the cloud. So it's more like a digital twin itself. And this part is accessed by all the different components. Now, if you see, there is asset strategy and performance, that is the ASPM, wherein you can perform different kind of assessments here, wherein you can look at risk and criticality assessments, you can look at checklist, which is also integrated with a mobile solution called SAP Asset Manager. We have a slide in the remaining part, we will come and briefly touch upon that as well. Then we can also do the failure mode and effect analysis, then you can also have the reliability centered maintenance. So, yeah, these are the capabilities. I would not want to again repeat the same thing. So I would like to move on. But our focus mainly is the AIN itself, with it's the asset intelligence network, wherein I mentioned previously that it's all bringing up people together, different roles together. And that is where we see. So we have the design to operate functionality in the AIN, which is nothing but, you know, the entire life cycle of the asset itself, starting right from the the design part of the asset, moving on to the planning for it, and then also manufacturing, delivery of it, and also operations. So IAM brings in all these phases together and makes the whole life cycle of the asset itself connected together, you know? So right from its design to the operation, it is together. You can see it in a single mode in the IAM solution. So this, again, it's like a brief showing about how every different OEMs that are there. Now you have the operator, you have the manufacturer. So this, you have an equipment here, which is a model E89. If you see how it is seen in different manners, it's the same equipment and it's the same asset in the end, but then they have a model that can be defined and they have a view of it that can be seen. So that is where the whole of AIN comes into picture, wherein you can connect the manufacturer or an operator can connect to a manufacturer to each other based on this particular equipment. This equipment as a service, it can be used to enable the cross-company business models. You know, you can with a collaborative process with data accuracy and also reduced manual work. These would be mainly the goals of AIN. And I quickly move on to the demo. I have with me Disha here, Disha Palan, who's a senior consultant working at Evora IT Solutions based out in Bangalore. Hi, Disha. You want to take on the demo?
Yes. Hello, everyone. Welcome. And thank you for being with us so far. Okay, so we thank you, John, for you know, giving us such a nice overview about the solution itself. And we now see, before going ahead and see how we actually use it, we would first look into the system itself and see how basically everyone who is connecting with the AIN are connected to each other and use the system efficiently. Yeah, so now in our scenario, we have Anuj, who is the operator. Let's think that he has already subscribed to AIN, and now he can connect to different business partners easily with this model, wherein he can send some connection requests, and already he has some connections with which he can already talk and get the model informations. Okay, but in case he does not have any connection, he can always search for different people or different connections or organization here and can connect very easily. Just in case he does not have those connections, what he can do is he can always go and invite the manufacturers in the system. So here he can very easily write the organization name and send the invite. Now he sent the invite to Priya in our case, and Priya accepts the invite or the invitation from Anuj, and she agrees to share the information. So now they can collaborate easily, wherein she will share the model. So the equipment base or the installation base on the operator is basically nothing but the model, or the product data is in the form of model from the manufacturer. So when you see the model here, you will have the information about what are the basically the highlights, the model information itself, how it is used, from which all companies it's used, what is the life cycle, and you know, what are the spare parts about the model, what are the components inside, and if it has the 3D model inside, which John was talking about. So you can easily see that these 3D models during the installation, which will help the technician in turn to finally understand and look into a 3D model and use and do it with no time. Yeah. Also, you have different documentations wherein you see different instructions, which Namita was talking about, that now the technician has some set of instructions inside during breakdown, what has to be done during installation, if there is any planned maintenance, what has to be done, etc. Also, we have we mentioned briefly about the sensor data. So each of the sensors which are for the equipment are mapped in here in the model, which is coming from the product data from the manufacturer itself, which then would analyze and will basically determine the health of the equipment. Yeah. And now we quickly go into the equipment itself. Okay, before that, if at all the equipment is not linked and a customer or operator already has it, yes, so what they would do is they can always run the smart matcher. What does this do is, if you have any model which is sent by the manufacturer to you, you can always search the match of the model to that particular asset with different match percentage. So you can say above 60% match, above 85% match, and if you get some model, you can always match that, and all the product data would appear in the equipment itself. In case we do not have a model and you want to product data, you can always put in some request to the manufacturer asking for the model information, and the manufacturer will approve it and recommend the specific model, which you can then match it with the equipment. So how does it help? Yes. So how attaching the product data to the equipment would help us. So with this, you know, there are three basic KPIs for the for equipment or asset to work. One is it should perform nice, it should perform, it should have very low downtime, and it should be allowing us to have the best strategies to maintain the assets itself. So all these things are handled in IAM together. So in the basic information, you will see whether there is any risk that we see on the equipment or not. If yes, then we would go for the assessment in a bit. Okay. With this, also with the IoT itself or with the sensor data, you can always configure the rules wherein, as we mentioned, it's a predictive, right? So how do we know? Based on the alerts or based on the sensor data which is coming, we would configure the rules that if the temperature is, let's say, for a pump motor, if the temperature is above 120 or above 90 degrees, you raise the alert here. And this alert can be of severity medium, which means it's just a, it's not an error, but it's just a warning. So maybe we might need the maintenance in future. And this would basically create a notification, and this would be sent to the backend ERP system synchronously. Yeah. And if you see, this equipment is already synced to SAP ERP backend system with the number what we see here. With this, then you will also see the indicator chart, which is nothing but the sensor data, which we can use, we can analyze weekly or monthly or, you know, day-wise. And also you can configure it that, hey, I want to see when were the alerts sent, when was a notification created, when was the work order created. So when you put this, you will see, okay, on April 25th, this was the time when this notification got created. Here, the work order got created. And you can understand that what is happening with the equipment or asset and how it is being managed. Now, when we go to the assessment itself, there are different assessments that we can perform. On the highlights, you will see risk and criticality, which was performed on this asset. There was a checklist solution that was performed on this asset. And RCM is nothing but reliability-centered metrics, and also the recommendations we see here. So here you see, we go into it one by one, just for a better overview. For risk and criticality, we use this matrix wherein, based on these questions, that how will the production line be hampered or damaged if this equipment is a failure, and how likely you see the failure. Based on this, defined by the reliability engineer, we would see if the equipment is in high risk zone, medium risk zone, or low risk zone. Okay, if it is in high risk zone, now, you know, reliability engineer has to always work with maintaining the costs and also deriving the best strategies inside. So how do we in IAM can derive the best strategies for our equipment? That's by using the RCM or FMEA. RCM is reliability centric. Right. So here, when you go inside, this basically would answer your questions about the machine. These are the following questions. So what are the functions? What are the basic functions for a machine which or the asset which we are looking at? If these are the functions, then what failures would happen if the machine does not adhere to these functions? Yeah. And in case this failure happens, then what are the different causes of this functional failure? And in case there is a cause, then what would be the effect? And for each effect, you can also then see the recommendations. Okay, so these recommendations can be of corrective type or preventive type, and these are then managed with the predictive maintenance review itself. So there is another tile here, or another application which we can use to get the review about the all the recommendations that are to be done. Okay, yeah, so there we go. And here you will see all the preventive maintenance or the recommendations that were created basically. And what you can do is you can always reject it if you think this was not needed or this recommendation is not needed anymore, it's corrected or something. You can always schedule it for maintenance, which would then synchronize to the SAP backend system. And always we can work through it. You can create a work order, etc. Yeah, and always you can also group them based on a different, whether it's instructions. Also, you can create it based on the maintenance plans and the tasks to be assigned. Yeah, this is about, also I saw somebody asking in the group that if you can have analytics inside. Yes, we certainly can have analytics inside. If you see here in the equipment itself, there is this analytics where you will map with the SAP Analytics Cloud. You have the solution on and then it would fetch the data and show you the analytics here. Yeah. And now let's see what happens or when do we actually use this. Now the question arises, okay, we know these are the things possible, but why should you use Asset Intelligence Network? So briefly mentioned by John and Namita, and we also would go again to the same thing just for a clear understanding again after the demo. So just in case your, you know, technician is missing the planning information, which, you know, you got when you when you got the model information. So you now have the technician has now the instructions, so there will be faster recovery and less downtime of the equipment, so it helps. Then there is network folders, which means that the equipment is all over the network, so the data is throughout the life cycle of the asset the same across, whether it's a technician, it's a operator, or it's a manufacturer. So it's really the real-time data and there's no mismatch of the data, which is a plus. Then the Excel sheets are not to be handled anymore, that you have to maintain so many Excels and then you get lost amongst them. So that's a benefit of it. Then there is there's no connection mismatch anymore between the service provider and the suppliers and even the manufacturers and operators, just so that we all are in the same page and they can easily understand what's happening and throughout the life cycle of the asset itself. Yeah, then there are different use cases which we already spoke about, that, you know, there is exchange of information, the transactional exchange is happening through sensor data, which is going back to the manufacturer. There's a smart matcher functionality, which basically tells you that this equipment suits best with this model, and thus you get the instructions and everything downloaded from the product owner itself. Also, you can request for the model information just in case you don't know what are the instructions. You always get that handy, and the downtime is then very less. Yeah, and the asset is performing very well in that case. Also, with the predictive asset insights, we basically you make use of the sensor data here. So then your equipment health is monitored with the machine learning, which is also integrated. So you get the sensor data, you perform some machine learning tasks inside, and then your health is determined of an equipment, and you can predictively say that, hey, my equipment might have failure in future, and that's why I want to contribute to the maintenance right away and plan my team, as John had mentioned. Then there is, if there is an asset which is breaking down again and again, you will go to the root cause, that, okay, this might be the problem with the asset, and that's why I want to go ahead and fix the main problem and not have the same problems coming again and again, and then the maintenance cost is encountered. With asset strategy, yes, this certainly helps us derive the best strategy for the asset based on different risk and criticality or checklist. If you want, you can also compare the checklist and find out the previous results. Now, what is the difference, etc., and how your asset is performing now. Yes, and there is a small workflow that SAP recommends for this. So just in case you want to derive the strategy, first you would need to go and see or assess the risk and criticality based on the metrics or the questions defined by reliability engineer. And this would then have your criticality category determined as A, B, or C. A is the highest risk possible, and B is the medium, C is the low risk possible. So in case if it's a high risk, then SAP recommends that we go with a reliability centered maintenance, wherein you basically see the failure modes and effects, and you know, understand the causes, and then put in the recommendations. And based on recommendations, we go to preventive maintenance review, and then we schedule it for maintenance, and then it goes or syncs back to SAP, and then the corrective or the recommended steps can be taken forth. And then based on this, if everything works, we basically evaluate the strategy, optimize our strategy, and then work through it and have the asset downtime low and well performing asset in place. And also when John shortly mentioned about the mobility solution, so this is also one of this is the mobility solutions for IAM, which is called as Asset Manager. So here the technician basically would get the work orders, the master data or equipment. So technician, this is the technician view of performing the tasks. So here you have you don't have to work on the paper anymore. What you were doing, the maintenance on the paper, this is done directly online or even without the network. But then, yeah, it's an offline solution, but you get the direct mapping, and there is no paperwork anymore. There's no loss of information, and everything works well with the online and offline data itself, wherein you have one-stop solution for it. So it has some key capabilities which I would like to brief here. It is, of course, mobile enabled, so no paperwork, as I mentioned. Then it's very easy and timely execution of it. So it's not something that you know, somebody else is creating, then you put down on paper, then you go to the workshop, you do it, and then the technician has to come back and put in the results, etc. It's all done at the same time, synchronized, and all works well in one flow itself. And it is also linked with a crew reporting or crew management. It is also there for the meter management, which is the ISU component itself. And it also supports the customer service. So this is a brief introduction about IAM and Asset Manager. We would like to hear from you if you have, if you are more interested towards, we go into the further details. I would like Namita to take on from here and explain you the startup packs, etc. Namita? Yeah.
So this is more talking about the offerings from Evora along with collaboration with SAP. And so basically, we are ready to deliver your projects with you. And it just summarizes how we go up about what our approach would be. We would conduct workshops to understand what your solution would be and map it to your requirements. And then also collaborate with you in carrying it out and, implement it. A simple use case is what we see. It could be implemented in a matter of 4 weeks' time. So this is a quick turnaround that we are talking about. So this next slide talks about more details, topics about what we would do in each deployment solution. Now we have the AIN use case, the ASPM use case, and PI. So we have split it across with every use case, what we're going to do with every component. And in AIN, if you see, we would be, so these are all the startup packs itself, which would come with a base offering. And here in AIN, if you see, it's the synchronization of the master data with the HANA cloud system and with your ERP system connected. And we would connect up to two different partners. If you look at ASPM, we will be setting up some checklists, some RNC, that is a risk and criticality assessments, and also the RCM implemented with the equipment itself. And the PII, as Disha showed, we can connect one sensor and create an alert and things like this. So this is more about the Evora's offering, what we are capable of doing. So this also talks about a little bit about the timeline, how we can do this. As I said, 4 weeks, and this is where our prepare, explore, realize, deploy phase would come into picture. For any questions, please reach out to us. You can get in contact with John, myself, Disha, or even Anchal. So our email addresses are already shared in the system. So we can quickly, if there are nothing else, any other comments, Disha, John? If not, then we can go on to the Q&A. I think we're running short of time. I think most of the questions have been answered, but I still see some more questions that came in here. I would like to go one by one, which the questions have not been answered. So the first question is from Kamlesh. It says, does it support Smart Glass? So, John, do you want to take this up?
Yeah, I mean, you've got a really good example actually of integration on the mobile side using Microsoft HoloLens and other other technologies that you've done and actually won an innovation award for just over a week ago. But I mean, out of the box, we don't have those capabilities kind of as standard, but the SAP platform absolutely supports integration of all sorts of different technologies, whether it's sensor technology or whether it's wearables or glass technology. This absolutely can be integrated into the solution, either from a mobility perspective or even just more broadly into the overall asset management platform. So yeah, definitely.
Yeah. I didn't want to really take it up and,
I mean, it's such a great example, and to win a Global Innovation Award for Avora. So this is the work that was done with OMV in New Zealand. Fantastic work integrating SAP's mobile solution and asset manager together with the Microsoft HoloLens. I would encourage everyone to have a look.
Thank you so much. Okay, moving on to the next question. It says, in which manufacturing industries you have implemented? So as John just mentioned, that this customer was our most recent customer with OMV. I can take the name because they won an innovation award from SAP just last week, as he mentioned. So this was in the oil and gas industry. So yeah, we have implemented here. This is a most recent one.
There's many different industries that we cover. Yes. So whether it's utilities, whether it's oil and gas, whether it's mining, whether it's public sector, travel and transportation. I mean, anywhere where there's a significant volume of assets, core manufacturing. So in mill products, I think someone asked a question around steel. So yes, absolutely. In steel manufacturing, chemicals, in all of these industries, we see use cases, and we have customers who are implementing SAP's intelligent asset management portfolio.
Can AI and capture data from equipment directly and guide for missing signal? Auto guidance.
I would take that up, Namita. So Bhupendra, this is possible with our machine learning capability inside. Of course, somebody has to train that, or the machine learning has to be trained. But yes, this certainly after that it would give the auto guidance or guide for the missing signal as well. So yes, it does capture the data from equipment directly, the sensor data basically.
Then moving on, is the standard equipment criticality analysis model and RCM model inbuilt in the design? Misha, you can take that.
Yes.
Favorite topic, right?
Yes, Atish. Hi, Atish. Yes, this is inbuilt in the design.
Can SAP IAM be used for electrical vehicles? Yes, straightforward, yes.
Yes, absolutely. So there, in fact, for some of the functionality like the network, there is specific functionality that has been added to support mobile fleets, right? So digital vehicle hub and, the ability to represent those vehicles. Not only does it support it, but there are some specific capabilities designed there for mobile fleet, not maybe just for electrical, but for all forms of mobile fleet.
Yeah. The next question is, what about MTTR and MTBF? To be honest, I'm sorry, I do not know these long forms. John, do you know this?
Yeah, no, it's a mean time to repair, a mean time between failure. So, Disha was showing, the failure modes and things like that. So once you've defined the failure modes and then actually, you're recording the failures and they're being linked back to those failure modes, then actually we can put analytics in place, and there are standard analytics out of the box that then understands, hey, what is the mean time between the failure? And of course, we're getting the execution data, so we understand that the time to repair as well. So absolutely, we can flow that information through. In fact, we have customers, and we're working with a customer in the utility space at the moment, who is not getting all the operational data, but actually is just analyzing the history of all of their notifications in the SAP system and actually doing text analysis. So using actually all of the information that's been captured in the SAP notifications and in the work orders to generate some of that that analytical reporting as well. So different approaches that we can take depending on what data that you have and where you have it. So even in cases where we don't have it necessarily in exactly the right structure, we can still actually do analytics on it and understand it to support those types of, you know, important KPIs.
Namita, we have a question from Mr. Jitendra Rathore from Skill Authority of India. He's asking for example of use cases in skill industries.
You know, I think there are a number of examples of different use cases, you know, across different industries. So maybe actually this is something that, Namita, that we need to send out afterwards is actually share a number of these different case studies across some of the different industries that with the team. So there's probably too many examples to go through here today, but I think actually in the follow-up, you know, maybe we can share some links to some of the videos and some of the, you know, the studies that have been done as part of those.
Sure, yes. We can collate that and send across. Actually, I have a couple of more questions on the same line, actually. And there is one question. Can you give some practical examples done in the industry so far and also share any other case study? So what I would like to mention here is that we will share whatever content is already there from SAP, but we are also looking at a next webinar coming in a couple of months, maybe sometime in June or July, where we are looking at the live example of the innovation award that we won with integration with HoloLens. And this is a use case that we want to present it as part of a webinar. So this is more like I'm giving you a sneak peek of what's coming in next. So there we are calling in the expert from the customer side who will talk about what the use case is and how the solution resolved the use case. So yeah, be tuned in.
I can see we have, you know, people from a range of different industries. You know, there's people asking about the automobile industry, and I mean, certainly in the component suppliers into automotive, we have a lot of those manufacturers actually who are part of the Asset Intelligence Network, who are sharing their information with their, you know, their customers, you know, using that network as well. In the mining and oil and gas space, we're seeing a lot of the operators are using that operational data and using predictive maintenance to be able to understand current condition, predicted future condition, and actually driving their work management process, you know, through those solutions as well. And of course, Avora, you know, in the mobile space around mobile execution, we're seeing that across a range of, you know, industries as well, where people are taking you know, the asset management system, putting it in their workers' hands on a tablet or on a phone, so they can take it out into the field. They can actually capture information about the assets that they're inspecting or servicing at the time that they're doing the work. So I can immediately capture, you know, the current work that I did, the parts that I used, the time that I took, the status of that work, whether I was able to complete it. I might get a customer to sign off on it. So many different, you know, different use cases, depending on whether you're going for collaboration using the network, whether you're looking to improve the performance of your assets using strategy and performance management or predictive maintenance, or whether you're actually just trying to improve the efficiency of your teams in the field through mobile execution. So we're seeing all of those different use cases being used in different industries. So, yeah, lots of different ways to get started.
Namita and John, we have pressed on time. I've got one last question. This is from Mr. Senthil Kumar Karuna Nidhi. Do we have connectors, that's gateway/protocols, available in the platform to connect to sensors or PLCs to collect the IoT data?
Yeah, we do, definitely. And so whilst there are, you know, a number of different standards in the IoT space and, you know, so standards like MQQT, you know, that we support out of the box, we also have, you know, and we call it plant connectivity, an adapter that actually then can connect to about 80 or 90 different standards. So, you know, so whether you're pulling data from a historian like an OSIsoft, you know, Pi, or you're using, you know, OBD, or, you know, any of the other, you know, operational sort of technologies, you know, we have a whole range, whole host of those that we can connect out of the box. And then, of course, if you have a very specific protocol that maybe is proprietary or you know, is not one of those standards, of course, a development kit to be able to extend and bring that data in as well. So, so certainly very good coverage there across across the ability to acquire data and bring it into the platform.
Okay, excellent. So, Namita, we have a poll question now. So, all the delegates, you are requested to just answer the poll question here. Yes, it's being flashed on your screen.
Namita, I'm overwhelmed by the number of questions and the engagement from the team here. We obviously can't keep up and can't answer all of these questions.
Yes.
I would love to, but I mean, we can look at these afterwards and mm-hmm. get answers back to everyone who was asked. Share yes. some more information. It's absolutely fantastic. Thank you so much, everyone, for sharing those questions, and we will absolutely follow them up.
And they are pretty interesting questions. I'm very eager to answer all of them, but in the constraint of time, I think it's not possible. But we can take it offline and look into all those questions.
All right. And I believe Achal and Namita and John have shared their coordinates to all the delegates. So, delegates, you're welcome to share in all your questions and Q&As. You can also email it to us. So I guess we can wrap this up, our panelists. So, ladies and gentlemen, thank you so much for attending this wonderful session by SAP India and Evora IT. And I hope you all got to learn new insights in the maintenance and manufacturing segment. So, thank you so much once again. Stay safe and stay healthy.